Vitamin C, also called ascorbic acid, is a water-soluble vitamin that humans cannot synthesize. Because of this, vitamin C must be obtained from the diet. Vitamin C found mostly in fruits and vegetables, and vitamin C has several important functions which make this vitamin a frequently tested topic on examinations. So, let's review every vitamin C function step by step. First of all, vitamin C facilitates iron absorption. Recall that when we consume meat or vegetables, they have iron, but this iron have +3 charge, and our organism can absorb only iron with +2 charge. So, in order to absorb iron, our parietal cells in the stomach produce hydrochloric acid. Hydrochloric acid oxidizes iron to +2 charge, and iron with +2 charge incomes to the duodenum, where duodenal enterocytes, bidivalent metal ion transporter, absorb iron from the intestinal lumen. So, the major concept here is that only iron that has +2 charge can be absorbed. Vitamin C can facilitate iron absorption. The reason is that vitamin C can also oxidize iron. So, by intake of vitamin C, we can convert more iron molecules from +3 charge to +2 charge. And the higher the amount of iron with +2 charge, the higher the iron absorption. What are the clinical implications of this? First of all, with deficiency of vitamin C in the diet, the lesser amount of iron molecules can be oxidized to +2 charge. This will cause decrease in iron absorption. And with decreasing amount of iron in the organism, the production of hemoglobin decreases, which can cause anemia. So, logically, if person has iron deficiency anemia, we can prescribe vitamin C, because vitamin C can increase the income of iron into the organism. And with correction of iron deficiency, we can correct iron deficiency anemia. But sometimes, increase in iron absorption can only aggravate the disease. It's the case when organism has iron overload, a condition known as hemochromatosis. So in this case, vitamin C supplements can only worsen disease progression. The second function of vitamin C is that vitamin C provides hydroxylation of proline and lysine in collagen synthesis. Why it's important? Here we can see a collagen synthesis. In this case, we won't review the entire collagen synthesis, but you can watch it in the collagen synthesis video on this channel. But the point here is that vitamin C deficiency disrupts hydroxylation of proline and lysine, because vitamin C is a cofactor of proline hydroxylase and lysine hydroxylase. So, without vitamin C, these enzymes do not work. How it affects collagen synthesis? Without hydroxylation, we cannot make hydroxyl groups. And hydroxyl groups becomes important in the step of collagen cross-linking, where we bind collagen fibrils into collagen fiber. And if cross-linking is disrupted, we cannot produce rigid collagen fibers. Instead, our connective tissue accumulates highly elastic collagen fibrils. And the problem is that collagen fibrils are very, very weak, which results in formation of a very weak and fragile extracellular matrix. This will disrupt wound healing, it will cause corkscrew hair and fragility of the blood vessels. Also, vitamin C participates in catecholamine synthesis, and in addition to this, vitamin C provides antioxidant defense. So, let's review these two functions. In catecholamine synthesis, we convert phenylalanine to tyrosine with the help of phenylalanine hydroxylase. After this, we convert tyrosine to DOPA with the help of tetrahydrobiopterin. DOPA undergo conversion to dopamine, and dopamine we convert with the help of dopamine beta hydroxylase to norepinephrine. recalls that we have two conditions which affect catecholamine synthesis. First of all, it's phenylketonuria, which affects phenylalanine hydroxylase. And also it's tetrahydrobiopterin deficiency. But the third condition is related to vitamin C. To explain this, we have to know that the cofactor of dopamine hydroxylase is copper. Without copper, this enzyme cannot function. But this enzyme requires copper with plus one charge. And with conversion of dopamine to norepinephrine, copper from plus one charge becomes reduced to plus two charge. And copper with plus two charge is inactive. So to activate copper, we require vitamin C, which provides oxidation of plus two charge copper to plus one charge. With vitamin C deficiency, we cannot reactivate copper. As a result, the activity of dopamine hydroxylase decreases, and without this enzyme, we cannot make norepinephrine, which leads to symptoms as fatigue, weakness, and mood disturbances. And the last function of vitamin C is antioxidant function. There are two key antioxidant reactions where we use vitamin C. First of all, vitamin C can directly inactivate reactive oxygen species. Vitamin C, in ascorbic form, can directly neutralize reactive oxygen species. But with neutralization, vitamin C becomes inactive. This inactive form we call dehydroascorbic acid. And to reactivate vitamin C, we need glutathione, which converts dehydroascorbic acid to ascorbic acid, which is active form of vitamin C. The second reaction where vitamin C participates is reactivation of tocopherol. Alpha-tocopherol is antioxidant, and after alpha-tocopherol neutralizes reactive oxygen species, tocopherol becomes alpha-tocopheroxyl radical, which is inactive form. The substance that reactivates tocopherol is vitamin C. So, if person has vitamin C deficiency, the reactivation of tocopherol becomes impossible, which results in alpha-tocopherol depletion. This impairs antioxidant defense and creates pro-inflammatory state. Also, with vitamin C deficiency, the direct antioxidant effect of vitamin C decreases, which also impairs antioxidant defense. Altogether, this causes accumulation of reactive oxygen species, which leads to oxidative injury. And oxidative injury manifests with vessels' fragility, decrease in immune response, and increase in hemolysis, which can cause anemia. The disorder caused by severe vitamin C deficiency we call scurvy. And typically, scurvy is precipitated by tea and toast diet. In simple words, to get scurvy, person should not consume any fruits and vegetables. And now we understand the pathogenesis of scurvy symptoms. As we see, most symptoms are related to disruption of collagen synthesis. It's a swollen gums, easy bruising, petechia, chemarthrosis. All of them develop due to the fragility of the blood vessel wall. Also, we see poor wound healing, perifollicular and supraostal hemorrhages and corkscrew hair. Symptoms as anemia and weakened immune response are mostly caused by impaired antioxidant defense. But excessive consumption of vitamin C can also be dangerous, and the major symptom of vitamin C excess is formation of calcium oxalate stones in the kidneys. So let's explain the pathogenesis of this symptom. With intake of vitamin C, we oxidize vitamin C to dehydroascorbic acid. After this, vitamin C undergo conversion to 2,3-decatecholinic acid, with subsequent conversion to oxalate. And the problem with oxalate is that we do not have any enzyme to degrade this molecule. So the only way to get rid of oxalate is to excrete oxalate by the kidneys. The problem here is that by the kidneys, we also excrete a lot of calcium molecules. And because oxalate molecules have negative charge, and calcium molecules have positive charge. They can bind together with formation of calcium oxalate crystals, which are very small particles which we can excrete into the urine without any problem. So, because calcium oxalate crystals are very, very small, they do not possess any danger to us. But increase in vitamin C intake leads to increase in production of oxalate. Calcium oxalate crystals can bind to each other with formation of a calcium oxalate stone. And now it becomes dangerous, because calcium oxalate stones can be so large that at some point we won't be able to excrete them. As a result, they can cause obturation somewhere in the urinary tract. And nephrolithiasis typically manifests as renal colic, hematuria, and urinary obstruction. And the last feature of vitamin C is that we use vitamin C for treatment of methemoglobinemia. Let's explain why vitamin C can help here. So here we have iron with +2 charge. Exactly this iron used by hemoglobin to pick up oxygen, which results in formation of oxyhemoglobin. But some drugs can oxidize iron to +3 charge, for example benzocaine. Hemoglobin, which has iron molecules with +3 charge, we call methemoglobin. And the problem is that methemoglobin cannot bind oxygen. And if hemoglobin cannot carry oxygen, hypoxia in tissues will develop. To solve this problem, we can prescribe vitamin C. Vitamin C reduces +3 charge iron to +2 charge, which makes possible for hemoglobin to pick up oxygen and deliver oxygen to tissues. It's a very high yield topic for exams. I hope you liked the video. Press like and hit subscribe button. And may the force be with you.